Cryptocurrencies such as Bitcoin have been exploited to support billions of dollars of illicit activity like cybercrime, tax evasion, extortion, ransomware, illicit drugs, human trafficking. This is indeed a national security issue.
For goodness sake, when did the internet become so annoying? Okay, apparently, and I might be wrong about this, Bitcoin may have hit a new all-time high briefly. You had to be quick to notice it. But come on, guys, have a little bit more pride here, please. The real one people want to see is Bitcoin over 20K. Celebrating before that feels to me like a lack of confidence, in all honesty.
Hello, 911 emergency. There's a handsome guy in my house. Oh, wait a second, cancel that. It's only me.
Should we be more confident right now? Well, I'm not scared. Let me put it that way. And that's despite a pretty humorous. Why is that so hard to say? Humorous. It was funny, albeit brief pullback earlier today. Humorous, funny, not because it wasn't serious. It was a near 10% drop for Bitcoin at one point, but humorous because of the way it happened. The entire market went down, not when Bitcoin posted slightly higher all-time highs on several exchanges. No, the exact moment phase zero of ETH 2.0 went live. A sell the news event is a way to justify the jump down in price, I get that. But just because you can jump doesn't mean you should jump.
You got shorts on, you're ready to jump.
But in today's video, I want to share with you why I'm not scared, despite this being probably the highest Bitcoin's ever been while I've been recording a YouTube video. Congrats, guys, we did it. And discussing one of the key potential propellers behind Bitcoin, probably one of the most bullish things I've ever considered. So first of all, why am I confident right now? No, it's not hopium, an indicator I've talked about recently, but still keeping a very close eye on right now in case it changes. One so simple as to be overlooked by so many, yet so consistent. 24-hour trading volumes. Going back as far as 2017, not even generally speaking, like practically every single time, big volumes after a dip is bullish. Big volumes during a rally, bearish. There isn't really an example where this rationale would lead you very astray. Looking back at March now, this was such a strong buy indicator. It should have been so obvious, but everyone was still scared during the uncertainty of the pandemic. But as the traders say, the charts never lie.
Who is the most powerful weed smoker among the three of you?
We don't smoke weed.
If any of you missed the video where I explained why this happens, very briefly, it's because whales need euphoric selling to buy without causing major slippage and euphoric buying to safely sell. We saw good volumes on our initial pullback recently, but the major thing I'm still looking for is nowhere close to happening. Isn't that weird? Bitcoin briefly setting new records, yet here we are on very little euphoria. Again, strengthens the narrative of institutions doing most of the heavy lifting here as they buy over the counter and not on exchanges, so we wouldn't see their buying pressure reflected on the volume charts. So things are looking very satisfying right now. I did recently have a chat with Mr. Christoph about the potential downsides of institutional involvement, which I thought was a pretty interesting and honest conversation.
Imagine leverage trading in crypto, what that percentage is for people that lose money.
Holy moly.
Like seriously, what is it? Is it 98%? Is it 99%?
We're starting a podcast together. I guess this is kind of an announcement. It'll be on a new channel, details to follow soon. Long term though, for Bitcoin, there is something we should all know about, but the implications of it are really starting to be felt now, like to ridiculous levels. MicroStrategy stock has nearly tripled within the past 3 months, taking the market cap to over $3 billion. Specifically October, things got really crazy. As you probably already know by now, this is around the time when they announced that they had purchased $425 million or so dollars, which is now worth about $750 million. Well played. primary factor behind this explosive stock growth is the fact that now people and or companies who, for whatever reason, can't purchase Bitcoin themselves, maybe because of a lack of regulatory clarity, can now have indirect exposure to Bitcoin through the regulated stock market by buying MicroStrategy stock, somewhat close to a Bitcoin ETF. But of course, the real story here is how many other publicly traded companies are looking at this vertical price action and also wanting to get noticed by investors. It's such a crazy powerful advertisement for Bitcoin. Any struggling company right now, of which there are possibly more than a few, must be very tempted to move any of their reserve assets into cryptocurrency. Even if they don't wholeheartedly believe in the future, the risk is certainly, I would say, managed by the chance that investors are going to like your stock, because the demand for a Bitcoin ETF is apparently quite high. Possibly a totally unexpected move the SEC could not have predicted, having blocked Bitcoin ETF after ETF application now. But here we are, and unexpected or not, it sure does sound good. Was that a smooth transition? There's no way that this can be allowed to remain unchallenged in the stock market space, not with gains like this. Satoshi was an absolute genius to design Bitcoin like this. One of the craziest figures is, how much Bitcoin can each person in the world own? 21 million divided by 8 or so billion people on Earth means each person can only have 0.002625 Bitcoin. And we know there isn't 21 million floating around out there. Millions have been lost. It's a lot less than that small figure I just gave you. Now the real question is, when will we see the likes of Amazon, Apple have Bitcoin as some of their reserves? Amazon is just an example, but it is one of the richest companies on Earth. They're currently sitting on $55 billion in cash. $55 billion. When you're a company this large, you're just as concerned about keeping the money you have as you are about making more. But what happens when holding cash means you're not losing physical dollars, but you're losing the purchasing power of those dollars rapidly. Never before in history have we seen a situation where holding cash has been so unfavorable, I think. I don't know, maybe someone will tell me before Christ there was this situation, and I don't know. But since the stock market's inception, around about 10% annual returns have been the average. But at least during a world war, the economy went down. Or during a depression. This year, we've seen record unemployment and major revenue losses from all but a few major tech companies. And the result? Stocks at all-time highs, housing prices at all-time highs, corporate bond yields, so I'm told, I wouldn't know, all-time highs, mortgage rates, all-time lows. Bitcoin had to be at all-time highs right now. There's no way it couldn't be. Cash is increasingly meaningless because reality is detached almost completely from the financial system. Companies will always need at least some cash, but increasingly, not a lot of it. And yeah, before someone in the comment section says, yeah, but they could buy gold. I mean, yes, they could. It could also buy more stock as well while we're at it. There's only one asset more uncorrelated to an economy. There's only one asset more scarce. There's only one asset that can potentially drive your stock price up by quite a lot. And so it becomes a win-win-win situation. If I've ever researched anything that made me bullish on Bitcoin, this is probably near the top of a very long list. Anyway, that's been it from me. Thank you very much for watching. I'll see you on the next one.
Hello, my friends, and welcome back. Today, I'm here to do a quick project overview on Parsec. As usual, I am not a financial advisor. This is not investment advice, and please always do your own research. All right, let's get into it. Parsec's goal is to connect blockchain activity to off-chain apps and devices, as well as build custom event triggers and power real-time automations. They use proprietary ParsecQL programming language that allows users to monitor and interpret an endless stream of data on the blockchain. Among the obvious use cases is monitoring the wallets of traders and ordinary users. They're promising to offer wallet protection, meaning Parsec will alert you to any unauthorized transactions on your wallets in real time. Then to really help out the owner, they can track to the blockchain to identify where your stolen assets may have went. In most cases, if they're sent to exchanges, they can actually get them back for you. I personally have had funds stolen from me, so this is a huge pro on my end. In October of this year, Parsec's technology was used to help KuCoin hack victims restore the balances and conduct a hard forking of their tokens in order to give back the tokens to the rightful holders. Among the non-obvious use cases are complex system integrations for financial institutions and DeFi projects that use the Parsec infrastructure to improve security, conduct audits, comply with regulatory requirements, and expand their workflows in other ways. They also have the ability to fulfill if this, then that automations on the blockchain. Here are a few things that you could use Parsec for. If you get a deposit on Bitcoin addresses A or B, then deliver the aggregated data about the deposits to Google Sheets. Or, if any of the deposits come from a blacklisted or high-risk address, flag the account for additional screening, then notify the compliance officer via Slack. All right, next up is their most recent accomplishments. In October, they released a blog post about their Epic 2.0 features, which I found most interesting was their public projects feature. This will allow users to subscribe to existing Parsec projects that were pre-made by other users. Projects themselves can contain smart triggers and user data. It is up to the owner of the public project to make them public, but any other user can subscribe to the public project and therefore listen for the resulting events of a smart trigger residing in this project. Think of it as like a pre-made feature on Zapier. To create the public projects, you are required to pay a certain amount in PRQ, which is Parsec's token. This also gives an opportunity to eliminate spamming public projects, and users are required to hold a larger amount of PRQ, but I wasn't actually able to find the exact amount. In November, an article was released about their integration of Chainlink's price reference data into their blockchain monitoring and automation platform. Basically, price data is now automatically fetched from Chainlink's oracles alongside the automated workflow Parsec's monitoring platform delivers. This data can be used to automate actions and set up triggers to monitor specific token pairs' price fluctuations. If you check out their team, it's pretty impressive. The people behind Parsec are experienced and highly qualified industry professionals that are passionate about blockchain technology. They state that their ultimate goal is to push forward mass adoption of blockchain tech by providing the necessary solutions. They want to be able to give everybody the ability to understand and manipulate blockchain data streams. Last but not least, they also have a slew of great partnerships, which you can find on their blog. But to name a few, they're working with Algorand, CryptoRank, Brazilian Digital Token, Dash, Upsala Security, Cryptonix, MugglePay, and BitGap. All in all, I really like the idea behind the project. Anything that can make crypto safer and easier to use is going to bring more people into the space. As we know, that's the ultimate goal. All right, everyone, that's it for me today. Thanks so much for listening and stay safe out there.